Hello and welcome to Thornliebank Parish Church's Sunday service for the 19th of March. Psalm 140. I know that the Lord secures justice for the poor and upholds the cause of the needy. Surely the righteous will praise your name and the upright will live in your presence. Amen. Let's worship the Lord. Let's sing, All Creatures of Your God, our God and King. That was rousing. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that we can come here together. Well, not in person, but certainly together of one heart and mind to worship you. You're God of light and truth, and you love us. Help us to love you more. We thank you for giving us hearts and minds that can know you more. Help us to keep learning and discovering more about you each day. for all knowledge leads to you. Help us to be aware of you in our everyday lives. Encourage us when life is difficult and when we're tempted to give up. Help us to learn more about your goodness and explore the world you have created. And be confident that you offer us a real life that's full of adventure. Lord Jesus Christ, we're sorry for the wrong things we do. Please forgive us and help us to forgive those who are unkind to us. You are great, for you created our world and it's good. We thank you for its beauty. Help us to live in such a way that preserves your world, to keep it good. And thank you for our families and our friends, for all the love you send to us. Please help us to be friends to others and to love others as you love us. And we make this prayer in the name of Jesus, who loved us enough to give us his own life. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory for ever. Amen. We are continuing to look at men of the Old Testament. And today we get to Genesis 37. And it's the story of Joseph. So I'm going to be reading verses 12 to 36. Genesis 37, 12 to 36. Excuse me. Now his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, as you know, Israel, by the way, is Joseph's dad. Got that one sorted out. Israel said to Joseph, as you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I'm going to send you to them. Very well, he replied. So he said to him, go and see if all is well with your brothers and the flocks, and bring word back to me. Then he sent him off from the valley of Hebron. When Joseph arrived at Shechem, he found a man wandering around in the fields and asked him, what are you looking for? He replied, I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they're grazing their flocks? Oh, they've moved on from here, the man answered. I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. So Joseph went over after his brothers and found them near Dothan. But they saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. Here comes that dreamer, they said to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal has devoured him. Then let's see what comes of his dreams. When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. Let's not take his life, he said. Don't shed any blood. Throw him into this cistern here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this to rescue him from them and then take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornate robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As he sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, what will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood. His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. When Reuben returned to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not there, he tore his clothes. When he went back to his brothers, he said, the boy isn't there. Where can I turn now? Then they got Joseph's robes, slaughtered a goat and dipped the robe in the blood. They took the ornate robe back to their father and said, we found this. Examine it to see whether it's your son's robe. He recognized it and said, "It is my son's robe. Some ferocious animal has devoured them. Joseph has surely been torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore at his clothes, put on sackcloth, and mourned for his sons many for his son many days. All his sons and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. "No," he said, I will continue to mourn until I join my son in the grave." So his father wept for him. Meanwhile, the Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard. Amen. Thanks be to God for his word. It's quite a lengthy reading, but I'll give an explanation of how we got to this point in a couple of minutes. And that couple of minutes will be spent worshipping the Lord, singing together a beautiful song, "Draw Me Close," sorry, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
So amazing, so
We're looking at men of the Old Testament, and so far we've learned about Noah, then Abraham, and now we arrive at Joseph. And the focus today is Joseph's brothers selling him into slavery. Here's what led up to this event. Joseph's father, Jacob, who was also called Israel, had 12 sons. He had daughters as well, for Jacob had four wives, busy man. And Joseph was the firstborn to his favourite wife, Rachel. Although Joseph was the firstborn to Rachel, all his brothers were older than him. And although Joseph was the youngest, he was his father's favourite. That's why Joseph was given his special coat of many colours, a magnificent robe that his brothers never had. And although if Joseph's favoritism wasn't enough, Joseph would tell his father about his brother's shortcomings just to reinforce his position as favorite. Bit of a creep, really. And what's more, Joseph had these dreams that he shared with his brothers. There we were, binding sheaves in the field. Suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright. And then your sheaves gathered round it and bowed down to my sheaf. In Joseph's dreams, he had his brothers bowing down to him as if he was a king, and he's the youngest. I tell you, most of us would be hard pressed not to give him a slap or at least a sharp word. Then there was another dream. The sun, moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me. The second dream had his brothers bowing down to him, along with his father and mother. I think I can understand why the brothers were a wee bit antagonistic towards him. And that brings us to the start of today's story. Jacob sends Joseph to Sechem to visit his brothers who are shepherding and to report back how they're doing, how they're getting on. When the brothers see him coming, they've moved on to Dothan. They decide to kill him. They've had enough. They've had enough. Joseph's dreams and arrogance had led the brothers to conspire to murder Joseph. The eldest brother, Reuben, he wanted to prevent his brothers from killing Joseph. And he convinces them to throw Joseph into this pit. And Reuben's idea was he would go back and rescue Joseph later. But before he can save his brother, the others have sold him as a slave to passing Ishmaelites who were Arabs. And they take Joseph to Egypt, where he's sold as a slave to Potiphar, the captain of Pharaoh's guard. Potiphar's wife tries to seduce Joseph, so he runs away and he ends up being captured and put in jail. Now, while in jail, Joseph becomes trusted. He's also known in prison as an interpreter of dreams. The Pharaoh hears about this, and the Pharaoh's been having dreams, so he calls on Joseph and says, "What do my dreams mean?" Joseph explains, and suddenly, Joseph is promoted to become the second most important person in Egypt. Joseph's dream interpretations, it's all about 7 years of lean, 7 years of plenty. And it saves Egypt from famine and makes Joseph incredibly powerful. Obviously, Pharaoh's extremely grateful to Joseph for saving Egypt from famine. What happens is the years of plenty come first. But instead of just having a feast and having a ball during the years of plenty, Joseph says, store some away because the years of lean are coming. The years of famine are coming. During the years of famine, they've stockpiled food, so they're okay. The famine that Joseph predicted does come. And it's tragic consequences for people in the region, and that includes Canaan, where Joseph's father and brothers live. The brothers travel to Egypt looking for food, and they come face to face with Joseph, who's able to save them from starvation. Now, Joseph recognizes his brother, excuse me, Joseph recognizes his brothers, and he gives them food and somewhere to live to survive the famine. But the brothers don't recognize him. And there's a problem. See, as long as the brothers don't have to see Joseph again, they could pretend they hadn't really done anything wrong, couldn't they? It was something they could forget. They don't have to see him. It never happened. Now that God has brought Joseph back into their lives, they eventually recognize him. Because Joseph lets on to them, "I'm your brother. I'm the one you sold." Now they were in trouble. They were in trouble because Joseph could have had them killed, but they're more worried about their father. They're more fa worried about what their father Jacob will do when he discovers what they did. Bit of a dilemma. At the very end of the book of Genesis, we read, realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brother said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you." Of course, the brothers have made this story up, of Jacob asking Joseph to forgive them, hoping that Joseph wouldn't take revenge. Joseph's response is so gracious and forgiving. "Don't be afraid. I am in the place of God. Even though you intended to do me harm, God intended it for good in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." That's the story of Joseph. But it raises a moral conundrum for us, doesn't it? Here's the question. Was selling Joseph into slavery by his brothers good because of the end result, or was it evil? It may sound like a silly question because it seems obvious, because the dominant opinion of the world today is that slavery is evil. No problem with that. If selling somebody into slavery is considered evil, then surely there's no question of it being evil to sell your brother into slavery. But what do we make of the end of the story? "Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good." Although Joseph's brothers did something evil, God intended good to come out of it. And if Joseph wasn't sold, he wouldn't have been available to interpret Pharaoh's dreams and subsequently to rise to a position, sorry, where he'd be able to save his family. Good things came from this evil act. Some people see God's hand at work in this story and think it must be good. I don't think I accept that position because it removes any responsibility from those doing wrong. Just because God rescues a person or a situation from the effects of evil, that doesn't mean this was God's intention from the start. Some may think differently. "Oh, well, God's hand was in this all the time. That was what was meant to happen." No. You see, to consider that the brothers' actions were God guided, get my teeth in, that destroys any concept of good or evil, doesn't it? It could be considered that because God saved the Israelites through Joseph being in Egypt, that his brothers were right in selling him into slavery. But to suggest that Joseph's brothers were right to sell him is to deny the evil in this act. I hope you're getting this. The moment Joseph's brother sold him into slavery, it's clear they're doing something evil. They're doing something wrong. But then we see that Joseph, being in Egypt, was able to bring about the deliverance of his family, which is why there's this question of whether selling Joseph into slavery was good or evil. It's a conundrum. You see the problem? This question robs us of any ability to judge whether things are good or evil. even based upon the standards given to us by God Himself. There's evil and tragedy everywhere we look. Could it really be possible that somehow God will bring good out of all these tragedies? Can we say that good will always come out of evil? Consider the Second World War. Approximately 60 million people lost their lives, both civilian and the armed forces. As a matter of fact, many more civilians were killed in this conflict than the armed forces were. Was the Second World War evil? Was the Holocaust evil? Is that even a question? But the industrialism required by war brought strength to the economy and it ended the depression of the 1930s. Once we'd recovered from the war, which took us up to the early 50s, we lived in boom time. In the 30s, we lived in depression. Improved technology required for war brought us jet engines, synthetic oil, radar, advances in medicine. Women were accepted in the workplace and earned more rights. The class system began to break down. And we saw the birth of the welfare state shortly after the war. The advances that World War II brought to the world doesn't allow us to say that war is not evil. 60 million people lost their lives. These advances weren't something we can say, well, hallelujah, let's have the war. That's just twisted thinking. Was there benefits came out of the war? Well, slim compared with the lives of 60 million people and the evil that was perpetrated. See, we have to acknowledge that evil exists and to claim with retrospect that some good comes out of evil. Some good can come out of tragedies, but it doesn't eliminate the evil that sparked the events of these tragedies. We don't give justice to millions of people who lost their lives if we say we were in a better place after the war than we were before it, because war is evil. What's more, we do a disservice to the gospel if we pretend that evil isn't real. See, the lesson we learn from Joseph's story isn't that God causes things that are evil to bring about good, but that God rescues evil situations and makes them good. God doesn't perpetrate evil. He rescues evil situations and makes them good. And that's what we should always remember. The lesson from Joseph's story is we have a God who can bring good out of the most astonishing evil. The selling of Joseph into slavery was wrong because it wasn't God's will for us to be slaves. Man did that to man. God didn't do it to us. Might have been better if God had made us slaves to him, because then we wouldn't be disobedient. But he didn't. He gave us free will. We do evil to each other. God doesn't. But God was not made powerless by the evil act, for he brought good out of that situation. It was God's will that Jesus died for us. It was always God's intention that Jesus would die for us. Now, we can't say that those, the Pharisees and Sadducees, those who crucified Jesus, didn't commit an act of evil. When the high priests and the Pharisees got together to plot against Jesus, when Pontius Pilate washed his hands, they weren't doing a good act. We cannot say that, because they didn't know that our Saviour had to die before he could be resurrected. They were killing Jesus. They didn't know about the resurrection. Neither did we, for that matter. Neither did anyone. Jesus had told us, but we didn't understand. Those who killed Jesus were evil men acting for their own ends. And yet God was not defeated by this evil act, for he used this evil to reconcile himself with us through Jesus' death and resurrection. Hallelujah. So we can't say that the crucifixion was actually good. But we can say that God is all powerful and he overcame evil because Jesus rose again. When we're overwhelmed by our circumstances, don't let anybody tell you that tragedy is for the best and it was all somehow meant to happen. Because when a tragedy strikes or evil happens, it's appropriate that we cry out to God. It's appropriate that we weep for our broken world. But we live in a world surrounded by tragedy. We live in a world where people are dying because of war, because of illness, because of man's inhumanity to man. And to pretend that tragedy is all part of God's plan is absurd. We believe in a God who can transform every situation. We believe in Christ, who was crucified, buried, although he committed no crime. We believe that he died, and 3 days later he rose again and is alive. That's testimony to God's transforming power. God was able to use the evil of those who crucified Christ. He was able to use the evil of Joseph's brothers to save a whole nation. God took the cross of Christ and transformed it. Terrible, sorry about this cough. And transformed it into the salvation of the world. This morning then, as we consider Joseph's story, and perhaps consider our own experiences of life, let's never forget we have a Redeemer God who conquered evil and can transform the most desperate of situations. Let the good that comes out of evil teach us that tragedy is not good. It's evil. But we have a good, redeeming God. Amen. Thanks be to God for his word and for his transforming power. Let's close our time together singing a wonderful song, Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. This is sung by the Gettys, and it's just wonderful. Sorry for the delay. I was turning the volume down on that because we're about to go into something like a 10-minute ceilidh, and I didn't think we needed that. May the Lord bless, preserve, and keep you. Give you peace and courage in every endeavour. Lift up your eyes and see his face and receive his grace forever. And may the blessing of God the Father, Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all and those whom we love, now and evermore. Amen. Take care of yourselves and may God bless you. Bye now.